It's Two on the Aisle with me, Charles Gross, and Leslie Hoban Blake. Tonight, reviews of The Thin Place, London Assurance, My Name is Lucy Barton, and Forbidden Broadway, The Next Generation. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Two on the Aisle. And hello, Leslie.
Hello, Charlie.
Okay. Are you ready to start with all these wonderful shows we're going to talk about tonight?
I'm ready to start with a really intriguing show. How are you with your... You like ghost stories?
I do.
Well, this is a really intriguing ghost story. And it's called The Thin Place. Mm-hmm. And The Thin Place...
Not to be confused with The Good Place, although many people would say that they are one and the same.
The Thin Place is that place just between reality and the other world, where your dead friends might or might not be. And this is a play by Lucas Knath, H-N-A-T-H. I'm never sure I'm saying that right. And I go up and down with Lucas Knath. I like some of his plays. I did not like his... Anyway, I liked this one very much. He did, of course, the Return to Doll's House play, Part 2, and I hated that one.
Yes.
This is... A woman sitting alone by the way, the lights are on. They leave the lights on in the theater. And this woman is sitting in a chair, and she starts to talk about her dead mother and the fact that her grandmother, dead grandmother, and
her
when
grandmother.
She was a little girl, her grandmother and she had this secret language, and they could speak to each other.
Well, she was basically, the grandmother was trying to teach her telepathy.
She said, I will call you from beyond when I die. So the woman has been sitting there waiting for her grandmother to call her. And she meets a medium. And the medium seems to hook her up with her grandmother, and she takes it as a sign. And then the medium says, you know what, it's all a trick. I'm a hoaxer. I'm playing games. And I'm not spoiling anything by saying this, because that isn't really the point of the play in the first place. The point of the play is, what do you believe? And how strong are your beliefs? And there is a 10, maybe it's 5 minutes, point where you sit in the dark in the theater. They suddenly snap all the lights off, and it's pitch black. And that's one of the scariest moments in the theater I've had for, you know, whatever show it happens to be, because you're alone with your own thoughts, and you've just had all this stuff crammed in. And so I just thought that he achieved a really great meeting of where we were and where we might be going, and that's what his play was about. And okay. I really, really liked it. I know Charlie didn't.
No,
so keep going, Charlie.
I did not. To me, I found this, you know, I admit I enjoyed her ending ghost story, mm-hmm. but you got to sit through a lot to come, you know, to what comes to something that you might hear at a campfire a lot sooner. My turn. And before that, she goes to dinner with the medium, she talks with the medium, she tells, this is my last meeting with her, and then she tells another ghost story at the dinner, and it all, I found it very tedious. I did not find it at all interesting. I know you did. I do like ghost stories in general. I'm good for
it
a good scare.
It twisted and turned, which is what I love. I love being thinking you're going down this path, and suddenly somebody actually makes you go the other way.
It was a little too twisty, so... Lacked comprehension as far as I was concerned.
No.
But here are my final thoughts. Can you pick them up? Can you tell what I'm thinking?
Got it. I'm thinking we forgot to mention the cast, and that's important.
By all
the
means.
The woman who is not the medium is Emily Cass MacDonald.
That's
the medium
Hilda.
Is the lovely Randy Danson. Trini Sandoval and Kelly McAndrew play two smaller roles. And the show at Playwrights Horizon was directed by Les Waters, who's a well-known director. And this is, I thought, given a minimal amount of space, it's all lights and sound and, you know, just really nicely done. That's my, you know, I would give it
I didn't
4.5.
Really?
I would give it
really?
4.5.
Oh. I wouldn't even come close to that. I could not get into the evening. I found it disinterested. I found, you know, she kind of think, well, how do we end this? Oh, I know. I'll just randomly tell this horror story. And that's how it felt to me. And I can only give this 2.5.
Okay. Well, that's why they have whatever.
Yes. Moving downtown a bit to something completely different. This is... a very old play revived at the Irish Rep Theater by Dion Boucicault, I think it is.
Dion Boucicault.
Boucicault, yes.
His name was actually Dionysius. It's the truth. I'm not making that up.
He changed it for professional purposes?
Yes, he did. Wouldn't you?
Okay, I guess. Okay. This is a farce. Drawing room comedy type farce, crossed with a soap opera, or perhaps kind of the soap opera that you might have seen on the Carol Burnett show. It's got all these overacting in a good way with these overdone gestures that would feel right at home in an old-fashioned soap opera or perhaps a silent movie. Let me attempt to get through the plot. All right. Sir Harcourt, a man well into his middle age, is going to marry this very nice young lady who is closer to his son's age, because the lady's father left her an estate, but only if she marries him. Exactly what was the incentive for this, I'm not sure.
The incentive is it's a 200-year-old play, and in those days, that's what they did.
Okay, but his son, Charles, who is of the right age, meets his future stepmother and falls for her. This sets up a mistaken identity, interesting farcical situations mixed up both with a friend of the family, Lady Gay Spanker, this free spirit marvelously played by Rachel Pickup. She rides, she does all these things, and her husband is very happy to let her do it, and she gets into this contrived plot just to move things along. But it's just so funny to watch.
It doesn't make sense to even try to break it down, Charlie.
I guess not.
What is really important is that it was done at Irish Rep. I don't think you mentioned that.
I did.
And Charlotte Moore, who is one of our favorite people.
Charlotte Moore is the artistic director, and we have seen her work before. Charlotte, I didn't know you had it in you.
Well, we've seen, yes, you did, because she also did Finian's Rainbow.
Yeah, but that is a musical comedy.
Well, but this is a musical comedy without music,
this
and that's the whole
This
point.
Is an over-the-top farce. If she had directed Finian's Rainbow like this, it wouldn't have worked.
It had over-the-top characters.
This works beautifully.
And one of the reasons
But you have to restrain them to keep a foot in reality, given the plot of the show. Here, all the stops are pulled out, and we have a wonderful time.
Sir Harcourt, the elder,
yes,
played by
Colin McPhail.
And if he wasn't perfect, the rest of the show wouldn't be. Everybody works up to him, though. His name is Colin. I'm going to hope I get this right. McPhillamy. Thank you. You did that very well.
Thank you.
And Rachel Pickup, by the way, is the daughter of Ronald Pickup. No, she's the niece of Ronald Pickup, a rather well-known British actor.
Certainly the standout in this cast. And is a good cast.
When this play came to America back in the 80s, Lady Gay Spanker won a Tony, or was nominated. I forget if she won or was nominated, but
in other words, the actress playing
her. The actress playing her, yes.
She came back. You know what? Lady Gay would find a way to accept the Tony on her own behalf.
And a lovely, the kind of free spirit that we always liked until free spirits got to be sort of rancid, but just a lovely free spirit indeed.
Right.
And a great supporting cast and lovely direction.
I will note Evan Zeese as a lawyer who appears periodically. I think his purpose is simply to be beat up by the rest of the cast.
He was so funny. That was Craig Wesley Davina, right?
Yes.
Dazzle?
And Caroline Strang as the young lady who does fall in love, does prefer the son over the father, but is not going to allow him to get away with anything.
And James Noon's scenery was perfect.
Yes.
Just perfect. All in all, and you know, the new stage really lent itself. It didn't need to be any bigger than it was.
Nope.
It was just divine.
It worked.
What would you give it?
I would give this 4.
Why not 4.5, which is what I would give it?
I really
enjoyed it.
I could be persuaded.
Dion Boucicault was a roué. He was not an attractive guy. He was a little bald guy. Nothing wrong with bald guys, but little spindly bald guy who went just up and down the length and breadth of America and England as well, womanizing and writing plays, and left a swath of, was not successful financially, but, you know, we still know who he is.
I don't know. With a play like this, I don't quite understand why.
It was his first play.
It was not.
He also wrote The Octoroon. He also wrote The Chagrin, which we saw down there. We've seen other plays of his down there.
You
don't remember.
No, but this is something I will not forget.
Well, I'm happy to hear that. I enjoyed it immensely.
So we're moving back uptown.
Yes.
To another great lady.
Yes.
Who has played free spirits in the mode of Lady Gay Spanker, but is playing a different role here.
My name is Lucy Barton, and this is a one-woman show, basically, starring Laura Linney. Mm-hmm. And it's really intriguing. It's based on a book I didn't read, adapted by some people I've never heard of. So I don't have anything to say about any of the background, except, of course, mm-hmm. on Laura Linney, whom we know and love, sometimes more, sometimes less. But I think the last time I saw her do live was also at Manhattan Theater Club. It was in The Little Foxes, and I saw her play both.
I think that's the last time I saw her, too.
Here she plays two roles, but she plays them at the same time.
Yes.
She plays a daughter and a mother. Now, the daughter is in the hospital with a for
complications as a result of an appendicitis
yes,
operation.
Right. And she begins to talk about her mother appearing at the foot of her bed. And I don't mean appearing. I mean, she talks as if the mother is there, and then she walks across and sits in the chair and plays the mother. Mm-hmm. So the woman in the hospital, Lucy Barton, is a writer. And she starts asking her mother to tell her stories. And you kind of don't know why she's asking her mother to tell her stories. I guess because they don't really have a good means of communication, so it's something that her mother can do while she's there. And but you get the sense that she's going to write these stories because she's a writer. And one of the parts of, about this is that when you're a writer, you sometimes infringe on your own family, and a lot of times. And you appropriate things that you shouldn't appropriate. But the mother is telling random gossip about the town from which she comes from, Anyway, Richard Eyre, who is a famous British director, has done a marvelous job of keeping us in the loop. We know when it's Lucy. We know when it's the mother. There, it's an empty set. It's just a chair and a hospital bed. And then suddenly, the projections take you to the view outside the window of the Chrysler Building, and also to the wheat fields. I'm sorry, not wheat.
Corn?
Short, low, corn and something else.
No, corn is not low. Corn is as high as an elephant's
soybeans.
Eye.
Soybeans and corn. It's young corn and soybeans. Okay. And so you see all these green fields. And it's beautifully done. It just overlaps very nicely.
You know, there are a couple things I do want to point out. Mm-hmm. Lucy's mother, Lucy is married with a child. Her child is really too young to see his mother looking so bad in a hospital. Mm-hmm. Her husband has a phobia of hospitals, so he stops visiting her. The mother, who she has been estranged from for many years,
yep,
comes
right.
all the way, you know, from the small rural community where mm-hmm. Lucy grew up in dire poverty. It's the first time they've seen each other in many years. Mm-hmm. So, but the play, I did enjoy this play very much. I like Laura Linney's performance. I've been a fan of hers ever since I saw her swinging on a trapeze at Circle in the Square many years ago. But there are a couple of questions.
What show was that?
It was a long time ago. I will come up with it.
But right.
It was the first time I ever saw her. And again, she played, her character reminded me a bit of Lady Gay Spanker.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But the couple of questions, this is a 90-minute show, which is about as long as a one-person show should ever go on. And you get a very detailed version of her life. But there are a couple of things that, at least to me, were missing. You know, she becomes estranged from her parents after she gets married. Maybe I missed it in the play, but I never quite understood what it was they really didn't like about her husband. Second, later on, we find that years later, after the hospital incident, she and her husband get divorced. I would have liked, you know, it's a relatively minor thing given the context of the play, but I still would have liked to have had an idea of why they grew
you
apart.
You know, they mentioned it, and I don't remember it. I know they mentioned it.
She has this beautiful view of the Chrysler Building, and I'd certainly like to know which hospital in New York City gives you that type of view of the Chrysler Building.
Well, you could call Bob Crowley, who did all of that,
maybe it goes back to the novel itself.
I will say one thing. You mm-hmm. said something about 90 minutes is about all. You know, you did your show.
I did 60 minutes.
Well, it's not. I wasn't talking about the mm-hmm. time, but you managed to find a lovely conversational tone. I never knew who she was talking to here. She talked to everybody in the mm-hmm. audience, but I never knew who she was really talking to because mm-hmm. she was a woman sitting on a hospital bed. And so somehow she broke the fourth wall, and I never quite understood that.
Right.
And I never thought
Well, she's actually out of the hospital when she's telling. This is a memory.
Yes, I understand that, but I still don't know who she's talking to tell the story, and I always need to know that. And the other thing is that as much as I love her and as much as I enjoyed this performance, it was always a performance, I never felt she was talking to us. I felt that it was an actress acting. Mm-hmm. And that spoils it for me. I would have liked to have seen something it was an opportunity for her to kind of do that.
But even when she was playing the mother?
Yeah. When she was playing the mother, obviously she was acting. That was a part. But when she was talking, just as the writer, I got a sense of a person talking. I got a sense of an actress acting.
That's interesting. I think you tend to be a little stricter about this sort of thing than I am. Well, because, we've had this discussion before. You have seen a lot of one-person shows, and this is a common complaint, and for whatever reason, it does not seem to bother me as much.
You're talking about who they're speaking to.
Right.
Right. This is not just that. This is I get past that. This is about the performance rather than a spoken, rather than really being a person telling me a story.
Right. Right.
That part
The
woman in Thin Place, I thought, was telling me a story.
Okay, that's a very good comparison.
Okay.
I like this infinitely better than I like the Thin Place.
It's not a question of that. It's whether she was just speaking.
But I think you have a very good point there.
Okay. Thank you. All right.
That said,
well, what we give it?
I had a good time watching this play,
and so
I will give this 4 playbills, not 4.5.
You know, it was being recorded by Penguin Audiobook for a radio.
I assumed as much when I saw the audio here. Exactly at one,
Well, I haven't given it yet. I would give it 3.5.
Okay.
But I think I like the staging. I really like the staging a lot.
So do you think that it could go straight from the stage to an audiobook?
Well, that's going to be interesting. I mean, since she's playing both characters, you don't get the sense of how much work that takes, and it's not as much of a feat on the radio. They always do different voices on the radio.
Yes, they do.
So when I say radio, of course, I mean an audio play.
Right, of course.
But I don't know. I mean, it's not going to be as spectacular as it is. The feet is on the stage. The story is what will come through, and it's a good story.
It is. So I guess the question is, would this be worth listening to as opposed to just getting a recording of the book?
Well, that's
and
it.
Having
I don't
not,
know the
not
book,
read the
so,
book, yeah, I can't I can't answer
either.
That. But it is an interesting.
Right. So 4.5 and 3.5.
Okay. Yeah. He's back. This is something.
And we had him on the show. Yes,
yes we did. You can look for our interview with Gerard Alessandrini and Maury Yeston
on YouTube,
talking about Forbidden Broadway and Anything Can Happen in the Theater.
Right.
I never thought he'd go back to Forbidden Broadway after he did Spamilton. Mm-hmm. Spamilton, to me, Forbidden Broadway was his Das. Spamilton was his Windows, and it really took the. Forbidden Broadway. Well, it took it.
No, it took me a minute to figure out what you were saying there until you said Windows.
It kind of took it to a new plane, but he's back with Forbidden Broadway, and it actually made me very nostalgic because although everything here is brand new, his first number is based on a chorus line. God, I hope I get it. Which is God, I want to see it. And the first time I saw Forbidden Broadway, and this is over 30 years ago.
100 years ago, yes.
That was his opening number.
Oh,
now
really?
It's been retooled. He says, God, I want to see it 2009. So that this is not a rehash. 2019, excuse me.
I was going to say,
So we won't, no 30-year-old Annie, no Les Mis.
Right.
This is Hadestown, Moulin Rouge, Evan Hansen, Fosse Verdon. Judy Garland, the recent movie with Renee Zellweger, I have no idea why that was included. It's really, I don't associate Judy Garland
juicy,
with Broadway.
It was a juicy bit for an actress to do.
I suppose. Also, The Prom.
He also does Fosse Verdon, which is TV.
Yeah. Well, but given their Broadway history, I think that was warranted.
Judy played the palace. I guess that's why. I'm not justifying.
All right, you're pushing. And a graduation speech by Hal Prince. So all in all, as with any edition of Forbidden Broadway, I think if you've seen the shows, if you're familiar with the scores, you're going to get a lot more out of it. I always enjoy Gerard's work. Some summer hits, summer misses.
I think Gerard's real talent, aside from being able to parody and do satire and et cetera, which is a prodigious talent, is his ability to find young talent. There's never less than a good, and sometimes
That's
a really
true.
Stellar performer in anything that he does. And I will go quickly through the names because, quite honestly, only one person I do know. All right. Chris Collins Pisano, Emmanuel Houston, Aileen Magayotira, Jenny Lee Stern, and Joshua Turchin. Joshua Turchin is 15 years old. I was sitting in the back with
him. And that's
his
a first for Forbidden Broadway.
Yes. Yes, but Gerard himself said that kid. So he obviously has he really feels that this guy has a lot of talent. And of course, to do shows like Evan Hansen, to really have a kid playing it is, you know.
Yeah, it certainly enhances it, but.
And guess what? Mm-hmm. That kid just went into Evan Hansen.
Okay,
so
So
the role.
A Forbidden Broadway alumni makes good. We finally get a Forbidden Broadway person on Broadway.
Yes. So, okay. But I thought that was so. He really did find somebody. But the women, as always, the women have incredible voices. And
you know, here you have to step into so many roles. You have to be Judy Garland mm-hmm. 1 minute. Mm-hmm. You have to be Patti LuPone another minute.
It was Renee Zellweger.
Oh, all right. Yeah, well,
that was the point. She was doing Renee Zellweger.
You have
Zellweger
to be Patti LuPone, even though Patti, this is the rare Forbidden Broadway that doesn't have Patti, even though
she's
coming back.
And she's on Broadway, yes,
even
I know.
Though she will
I
be
know.
Coming back
I
to
know.
Broadway. Soon, it's classic Forbidden Broadway, and it's hits or misses. Enjoy. Three and a half.
It's at the moment it's still running. It's at the York.
It's at the York. Yes.
Directed by
Gerard Alessandrini.
Directed. Well, it says written and yes, directed, written, created, and directed by yes, scenic design by James Morgan. It's the same scenic design that he used for the Maury Esten show.
Which is coming back.
Is it?
There'll be a special performance, I think, on March 6th.
Okay.
I think there's a larger orchestra.
March 6th?
I think so,
I thought
yes.
he said that they had done a
they did that
CD.
Too, yes.
Right,
they've
okay.
Done, but they are bringing it back.
Anyway, so what would you give it?
I would give this 3.5.
Yeah, I'd say it's about 3.5.
Yeah. Right. And I will add a story to it.
Okay.
Now, one of the most famous Forbidden Broadway numbers comes from Annie. You have a 30-year-old cigarette-smoking Annie.
Yeah,
I'm 30 years old tomorrow. I haven't worked since. Well, York Theatre, as they often do, posted a whole history of Forbidden Broadway on their wall in the lobby. Mm-hmm. And there you will find a picture of a 30 or 30-something Andrea McArdle, Broadway's original Annie,
yes.
who apparently performed that number
yes.
with the wig, with
yes.
the dress,
yes.
for a charity event.
Yes.
I don't know of any other incidents where original stars did their Forbidden Broadway
right.
roles, but that's something I would have loved to have seen.
As we said to Gerard, you know, when at the height of Forbidden Broadway, people would come and say, "You haven't parried. I'm not in the show. What's the matter? Don't you like
mm-hmm.
me?" You know, and interestingly enough, some of these people are so young they probably don't know the history of Forbidden Broadway. The new stars on Broadway, in all likelihood, from the new shows, don't necessarily know what that's all about. Fausto Fantino might know from Tootsie. By the way, the kid does Tootsie.
Yes.
And that's really he's the yeah. kid. Listen to
again. The one thing Forbidden Broadway has always had is a multi-talented cast and a versatile cast, which
right.
you have to be.
And it's always a cornucopia. You get to take out what you want, you know, and blah, blah, blah. So as long as you had found a story you wanted to tell, I'd like to go back to Dion Boucicault, because I didn't really know. I mean,
who wrote London Assurance?
I didn't know about his personal life. He lived from 1820 to 1890, and as I said, he was a roué. But I don't know if we can get a close-up of this on my probably
now, what does a roué mean?
Roué, a mm-hmm. guy who plays around.
Oh, okay.
Man about town, guy who plays around with women. So this was a period of time when everyone was circumspect, but the theatrical people always had. And Dionysius was a good name for him, given the playing around part. He came from a prominent family, he began acting, and his first play was done in 1841. And this was the first play. London Assurance was the very first play. And he had a wife, and he was having it off with the various actresses in the company. He kept writing plays. And then he married a wealthy older widow, which I was, and managed to go through all of her money, which I think is hysterical. And then they traveled across the country. And in New York, he married another actress. He liked actresses. Well, you know,
wealthy widows.
When you're in the theater, that, you know, there's a lot of that going on. And then, by the way, at that point, he did a play called The Poor of New York, The Octoroon, and The Colleen Bone. The last two were done down at IRT. The Poor of New York was just done at that little theater on East 4th Street that we practically never get to, Metropolitan. It's run by Alex Rowe, and he always finds these wonderful plays. So he played in, he opened and closed theaters in New Orleans, New York, and Washington, D.C. So it reminds me of somebody. And then He returned to London, and he was going to open another theater. I want to see the story of Dion Boucicault made into a movie. I really want to see it made into a movie. And I was trying to think of what actor could play the part. And I came up with, remember the guy who played on Deep Space Nine? He was the out-of-space doctor.
Yes, Julian Bashir. The character was Julian Bashir. I don't know who...
Okay. Yes, but I believe that's the guy's name. I could be
wrong.
Well,
that was the character.
But sort of a short, balding.
No! You're thinking of the guy who played Quark, perhaps.
Yes, as long as he didn't have those funny teeth, he wasn't a Ferengi. He was a. Anyway, the point that I'm trying
not quite
to make
now
is
now I don't know who you're talking about.
It doesn't
about.
Matter. You need an older actor who doesn't look like a roué, who doesn't look like somebody who do very well with women playing this part. And then have him sort of run through all of this. I think it'd be kind of funny. Anyway, he bigamously married his last wife. He was already married to someone else. She was 21 years old.
How old was he about?
Well, he died in 1890. He was 70.
So he was like close to 70?
Oh, wait, no. Yeah, 70.
Okay.
So he was old enough to be a grandfather at the time.
Indeed. And,
I just find that I think, see, I want to write that play, and of course I'm never going to. But that's the one I want to see.
Okay. Okay. Yes, in these Me Too times, Leslie wants to see about this guy, this playwright who was doing all his actresses.
Well, he almost always married them, so, you know.
Oh, well, he was a male Liz Taylor. What can I tell you? All righty.
Okay.
And that is our show for this evening. When you go to the theater, look for Leslie and me, us too.
On the aisle.